And action.
I'm out of tape.
Don't make me nervous.
Batteries are dead.
Seriously, what the hell, man? I'm getting rattled here. Make it work. Because I'm an idiot, I can't be trusted with remote controls.
You guys practicing out here all day, or are you just...
Yeah, we'll probably go through the routine a few more times. We got a few things we need to work out. And yes, we are. And then
we're going to follow.
We're not going to be here all day.
The Sean Tucker way and get in a round of golf before you leave.
That's right.
He practices in the morning. He plays golf in the early afternoon, and then comes out and practices again.
Does he?
So, yeah.
Yeah, no, with as hot as it is today, we'll probably squeeze in a couple more things and then call it. And then we're coming out here a few times this week. So.
Okay, well, I'll stop out. I'm going to be spending most of my week down in Dayton at the show. But,
that's right.
My full-time job's here, so are we ready?
Yeah.
All right. Let's start with both of you give your names, spell your names, and we're here with Redline. So we'll start with you, Ken.
Okay, Redline Air Shows. Ken Reeder, R-I-E-D-E-R.
John Thocker, J-O-N-T-H-O-C-K-E-R.
Okay. You were an addition here, a welcome addition to the Dayton Air Show at the last minute to fill in for the Blue Angels. How's the feel of coming to Dayton for what I think is the first time, am I correct?
It is. Absolutely thrilled for us because it's a hometown show. Been coming to this show since I was a teenager. And to be flying here, well, I didn't see it coming when I was a kid. And so especially coming with family and a few friends that are going to come and watch it, it's just great.
So you're going to have a lot of familiar faces in the crowd for both of you this weekend, next weekend?
Yes,
we probably will. I've got a lot of friends here. Maybe my son and daughter might get a chance to see the show for once. They're always busy, so this is a close one for them to come see. So we're excited.
But it really is an honor, especially growing up near Dayton. I grew up in Cincinnati, but when my wife and I first got married, we moved to Miamisburg, and I learned to fly at Moraine Airport. So the Harold Johnson and Daryl Montgomery and Billy Bruns and John Black, all these air show performers have come out of there over the years. Mike Brown and Billy and Harold flew over Kings Island for many years. And to be honest, those are my mentors for this. I started doing...
Harold Johnson is a local legend.
Yes, he is. And I started flying with these guys, right after I got my pilot's license. My first aerobatic ride was the day I soloed an airplane, and it never stopped after that. That's many years ago.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Chris? You've been flying around the area. You were here at the Hartzell Air Show a few years ago. I love your performance. I mean, it's a great act. Where else around this area have you performed before, and where are you going the rest of the summer?
We've done a lot of shows up in the Cleveland area in the last couple of years. The Cleveland National Show, a couple smaller shows on to the east and west of Cleveland. And then we've also done the Moraine Show last summer. And we've done Waynesville, which is a local grass field in Cincinnati. So we've done that on Labor Day weekend for the past few years. So.
Yeah, that's kind of our, maybe give it back a little bit to the area. Most of our shows seem to be, it's kind of funny, they seem to be 2 hours away. All the way around from Oklahoma City to New York area, Greenwood Lake. This year we're performing again there with our night show. Again, we have a fireworks that we put on our wings for the night show, which is just, that's a bunch of fun. That's a hoot. And we're... performing at Oshkosh, both night shows and a couple day shows also.
Oh, wow. Want to get to see you out there.
Yeah, Sun and Fun. For the remainder of the summer, we've got Traverse City, Pensacola Beach, Florida. We've got Port Clinton. That's another local show. Boy, there's so many. I get Reading, Pennsylvania. And last year, we flew everywhere from Canada all the way to Costa Rica.
Wow.
So we flew all over this part of the world.
Yeah, this is something I probably won't put in here, so tape recorder, stop listening.
Yeah.
You mentioned some really big shows, and you've mentioned some really small shows.
Right.
I don't know about you guys, but I get a bigger kick out of a lot of small shows than the big, huge ones. Does it make a difference flying at, say, Oshkosh as opposed to here at Hartzell or one of the small shows at Moraine?
Well, it's always fun to see the big, huge crowds when we're flying. It gets us excited. But at the same time, we're much closer at the small shows. We can interact with the kids more. So they might not get the opportunity to go to big shows. So it's fulfilling to go do the small shows too. So.
We bring hero cards, and there's nothing more fun, to be honest, than walking down the line and having all these little, two adults, but most of them are little kids coming over, and they just see the picture of it. So for us, the little shows are, and honestly, a lot of times we're the highlight, the headliner show for the small stuff. And the bigger stuff we're putting in the mix, but we did Langley Air Force Base a few weeks ago, which was really cool to be in that mix with all those folks. But I really enjoy going to the small shows. So if I had to make a choice there, I love the mix, that we get. And
I'm really excited about doing the Dayton Air Show.
I'm really excited about Dayton. I'll say that right now. Yeah. This is, Mike Brown is a real good friend of mine and used to fly that show for years and years and years. He's not going to be able to make the show, but me just calling him up and saying, hey, guess what? That was a real charge. And he was taking me here in the 80s and 90s, and we would go to the performer party sometimes after. And to be on the other side of that fence, being the performer that they're coming to the party for, it's thrilling. For me here, I go to these performer parties all over the place, but this is so sweet for me.
It is. And you guys, a little of the mystique is off of it. I know a lot of people who are coming to Dayton for the first time, you're the birthplace of aviation, but you're kind of familiar with that, so you know that you are flying where flying started.
Yeah.
That's very exciting to be a part of that. Where it all started. We go to the Air Force Museum a lot, and tell people that's the best museum in the world. You have to go there. Really? Oh, wow.
Two weeks ago when the Solar Impulse was here for the first time or for the only time.
Yeah.
And talking to people from Switzerland, I mean, they were just thrilled to be. Oh my God, this is Dayton, Ohio.
Yeah.
It is. It's very exciting.
Yeah.
It's an honor.
Yeah, it really is.
I'm doing all the talking.
Okay. What types of maneuvers do you guys do in your team?
Well, I'd have to say that our favorite maneuver is probably the quarter roll loop. You can see that at the end of the show where we turn the loop and head away from the crowd and then break and split in front of them. We call that the switchblade. It's fun to perform. It sounds good. Actually, a lot of the venues will put our voices on the PA, and it's kind of neat to see this happening. So, But the toughest maneuver would be the barrel roll.
Oh, yeah.
The toughest maneuver to perform.
Doing it in formation.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Just for me to stay perfectly synchronized, it's the toughest one. Because we're pulling and rolling at the same time, and to stay synced, it's the toughest for me.
And to make that work, you got to have a partner in this that is, unshakable. I want to say somebody that you can count on day in and day out to be in that position.
Mm-hmm.
And on the flip side, and it goes for both of us, whether he's in his position or I'm in mine. And like I said earlier, for us to make this work the best, I have to do very smooth, very predictable aerobatics. And I'm responsible for keeping us in the right position for the show, the pace of the show, and things like that. But even if I do all that perfect, it's his responsibility to make us look good. And so he, we joke around often that we'll look at each other and go, okay, let's switch for today. And we do that just to keep practice going. And after we get done, it's like, oh, I was bad. He looks at me, you did that wrong. Hey, you did this wrong. It's just kind of funny. We've both come so accustomed to where we're at it's really neat. It's really, it's, you know, it's, it is a ballet, I want to say.
How many hours do you practice before air show season? About how long does it take to where you are ready to perform your
practice
routine?
A couple times a week for a few weeks before air show season, two or three times a week. Air show season gets in, and then we're practicing at, you know, before the show a couple times then also. So we practice a lot.
And is, we'll fly probably, 20 shows. Right now, our schedule is going to have about 18. We'll probably get a couple more by the end of the year. And at that pace, we're flying a show about, almost every weekend during the heat of the season. So, in the week, we're based at the same airport, which is a huge advantage. Not very many teams have that. And we can go out and say, hey, let's run out for a half hour and then put burgers on the grill. So we'll run out and run through a quick practice. And even if it's, we'll call it up at altitude rather than going to a low aerobatic box, we'll go up at altitude and just practice on some maneuvers that maybe we would like to tighten up, or, something we saw in a video. A lot of our shows, we have, folks that are at the show that videotape our performance, and a lot of them end up being sent to us. So we can look back and go, it felt good, but now that I see it on tape, if we were to, whatever it might be, so.
Let's ask, how do you guys design your routines?
It started 5 years ago, honestly, that we started doing a simple loop, and then we built the show after that and beyond and behind that. The key is, everybody looks at, say, Sean Tucker's airplane or a jet, and they say it's all about power on the airplane. It is to an extent about power, but a lot of it also has to do with what kind of energy the airplane has. And energy comes from me having some altitude that I spend building speed to actually perform the maneuver. So the next maneuver or the previous maneuver has to build in well for me to have the right energy state to do that next maneuver. So how the show is actually built for each performance or each next maneuver, that's how I base what I'm going to fly then. Our package doesn't change. We avoid changing that. We just try to improve on what we have. It's very rare that we'll add something if a show wants us to. And it's very rare that we'll take it out. It's easier to take away. Of course, we'll just start the routine further into the performance. But so we've been doing the same routine now for the past 3 years unchanged.
Could you tell us a little bit about your planes?
They are called Vans Aircraft is the manufacturer of kit, and we bought those kits and we built the airplanes. Ken's airplane is 12, 13 years old, mine is 9 years old. We both have built multiple versions of these airplanes. So it's a kit, and we built it in our garages and basements and barns over the course of a couple of years, and then we've started flying them. And it's an RV8. It has a 200 horse engine. We cruise at 200 miles an hour for going cross country, and it lands at about 60 miles an hour. And
they're all metal two-seaters, and the kits were designed to be a light duty aerobatic, we call it sport aerobatic airplane, and but great cross country machine. So it's for airplanes. It's 75% faster than your typical training system 172, mm-hmm. and we burn about the same amount of fuel as that. Mm-hmm. So we're quite a bit faster. Our airplanes are all IFRs, fully equipped, autopilots, and everything. So for us to fly a show in our last show that we flew was in Oklahoma City. We're 3.5 or 4 hours away, and we can do that nonstop, and with the autopilots on, and it's a comfortable ride. Hmm. My airplane's been to Alaska, to the Dominican Republic, and Costa Rica, and Canada, so it's been all over this part of the world. And,
my goodness.
Yeah.
Nice. What's been your best memory or moment with flight? Doesn't have to be air show. Best moment.
My daughter was afraid to fly when we had a family airplane. She was very small, and she kind of cried every time we would go on a trip when she was, third grade, fourth grade. And we sold that airplane after I built my other airplane. And She warmed up to it later on and went a couple times with me. But one day she came home, and she was a junior in high school, and it was a beautiful day. And she said, "Dad, can we go flying?" And so I took her flying, and I had a, it wasn't a GoPro, but it was a, one of the first cameras, and I mounted it on the glare shield looking back at her. And I had it tied into our intercom system, and we went up and did aerobatics. And she had the time of her life. She was having a blast. And her name is Haley, and I called the video Haley Batics over aerobatics and Haley. And it's got like 3,000 hits on YouTube.
Oh,
and she's just having a blast back there, and it's a cute video. And that's probably the best time I've ever had flying, was with her doing that with my daughter. And we also took a cross-country trip back and forth to the West Coast and the East Coast later on that summer together. So that's my best.
For me, I had to say it's also related to my kids. It was the day my son learned to fly a glider over at Waynesville. He was 14, and it was his first solo flight. And I was just amazed to watch him do it at 14 years old. I don't think I could have done it at 14 years old. So really, and he got in there and took off, being towed up behind another airplane, and I just look at that and go, how is that possible? He's that young, but that's it. I didn't say that. Probably one of the happiest moments, a little tear in my eye, going, you gotta be kidding.
It's supposed to be more fun watching our kids experience things than even ourselves.
Yeah, it really is.
Yeah, it really is. Yeah.
You had mentioned a night show. What's involved with that?
Hours of preparation. Let's start with that. Yeah, the night show is a completely different animal than the day show. We have fireworks that are on the bottom of our wings. We built some specific rigs to hold all the fireworks on both wingtips. And then we electronically fire them in the airplane. So now we fly the air show at night in the dark. He's looking at me. I look very bright for a few moments. And he has to fire off fireworks all at the same time. Our performance is not as complicated by far as the day show, but that complication from the fireworks definitely fills your time. The performance start, the show starts with about 8 hours of rigging the fireworks. Our show might last 6 minutes. And we have about 180 events that are fired off of our wings during the show, so it's a whole lot of fireworks.
So 90 each?
90 each, yeah.
We look like we're going to war. Our racks under the wings looks like we've got rockets.
Actually, it's funny that you mentioned it. I'm so glad you did. This is, needs to be one of these off things. So it's a long drive to Cincinnati to Sydney, and my mind goes in really bad directions. So I was actually going to ask you this question, but this is a perfect lead-in. So let's say worst case scenario / apocalyptic whatever, or you're going to write a screenplay, whatever.
I know.
We get annihilated. Bad guys come in, and you guys had to defend the tri-state area. Could you do that?
Oh, we could come up with a way to do that. We could shoot things.
Honestly, in our airplanes, as long as we weren't needed to carry anything real heavy.
Real heavy, yes.
Yeah, they'd be probably interesting because we can fly and we've got some
practice.
Can they make
really light 1,000-pound bombs?
What's that?
Do they really light 1,000-pound bombs?
Oh my gosh.
See, I was so worried about that question, so I thought that's a silly question. I shouldn't ask it.
We would improvise, adapt, and overcome.
Yeah.
I think I've heard that somewhere.
It's like that.
The pyro things that you attach, is it similar to like what Bill Leff uses?
Yes.
It actually is. Yeah, he puts his on his wingtips. Ours are actually underneath the wing.
Underneath, okay.
They look like 5 pods on each wing of a cluster of rockets. In a way it is. But what that does to the airplane for the performance is you guys understand what makes an airplane fly, you know, thrust, lift, you know, weight and drag.
I thought it was money.
Oh, that's money. But honestly, all that stuff on our wings causes so much drag that we have to think a lot further ahead of the airplane to know what's going to happen. To have our speeds, because you know, as we descend for each maneuver, I'm looking at an altitude and speed, and I expect this to match. Otherwise, we fly through.
And I just look at him.
And he just looks at me and says, you better be right.
We have a pact. He's in charge of not hitting the ground, and I'm in charge of not hitting him.
Yeah. I like that.
I like that.
Yeah.
I didn't think that was your motto that you had out on your plane now, was it?
Yeah, the red line is the goal, not the limit.
Yeah, yeah. Not sure which one I like better.
Yeah, goal, not the limit. Yeah.
So, have you guys ever done a maneuver and thought, nope, not again?
Yes.
Yes. Oh, yes, we have.
Yeah, there's been a few that we put in the routine, and after we were doing the routine, we had to remove it. And early on, we removed some full maneuvers because it was just too much, too many G's. For too long, you know. So there's limits that your body has too, and then we had to say no. Okay, we pulled G's too many times too quickly here. We need to change this, and it's something your body becomes accustomed to, which is why Sean Tucker and all these guys, they have to stay in tune for that. For us, our G loads are probably a third less than theirs, so we don't quite hit those high limits. But
so you're at 5, 6, 7 G's max?
We're a 6 G max, right? And everything that you saw me do today, I pulled 5.8, just to give you a rough idea.
Okay.
5.8.
I know Sean, a lot of times, is up around 9.
Mm-hmm. And he'll pop with a real quick 12 here and there. Yeah. So it's a different, you know, different way that he flies. You know, he's flying a different machine.
What's the best part of an air show for you guys? What do you enjoy most?
Oh, meeting the kids afterwards, after our performance, and signing autographs for them.
And also hanging with the other performers, you know, before and after the show, comparing notes, that camaraderie that's built over, honestly, being around it for a long time, that they trust your flying, you trust their flying, and all of a sudden you're going, yeah, how'd that work out for you, you know, and where are you flying next? I really enjoy that.
We've had the opportunity to talk to the other teams, the guys from the Blue Angels and the Thunderbirds and the Snowbirds, and it's kind of fun. We get to spend some time at the Langley show talking to Alex from the Snowbirds, number 6, the guy that ejected. So we spent an hour and a half comparing notes on, because they do kind of the same things we do, the opposing solos. And in the past, we had talked to the guys on the Blue Angels, but I don't think we talked much to Jeff.
We hadn't
gotten to know Jeff.
We flew down he was the announcer last year, so we talked to him last year a little bit, but also down at Kingsville when we were down there, we got a chance. And so that's the toughest part of all of this is to go, and quite honestly, in the last, you know, few months, the air show season, of this season, I mean, it's been a little bit of a rough way to go.
Mm-hmm. Well, last year was the worst I remember in years, and man, we're off to a rocky start this year.
Yeah. It's a very unforgiving sport, I want to say, and that's the allure, you know, because it doesn't matter. Today, we had a wind down the runway. Next time I fly, we have a wind across the runway, and you know, so each performance we fly is in some way, you know, pressing that new boundary of what we're capable of.
That's why spectators have come to air shows since the 19-teens, you know, to watch the daring flyers, and I don't think anything's changed in the last 110 years.
That's right. I'd have to agree with that.
Well,
yeah.
Along those lines, too. Feed off of that question, you know, the danger of your profession and the expense involved. Was your family okay with you deciding, hey, let's do this?
Yeah, they. My wife's on board with it. She realizes that I have a passion for this, and that's just part of life. I'm passionate about it, and she understands. So.
Yeah, you know, and it's you kind of. For me, I have a construction company in Cincinnati, and the mix of flying and the construction company for me is just about right. You know, when I'm flying at a show somewhere, anywhere, or just flying, you mentioned this before about the performance, the big crowd or the little crowd. Our performance, once we leave the ground, other than me taking a glance and saying, oh, they're full today, other than that, realistically, I try to fly the best performance, whether it's at Waynesville or Dayton. And so my mind is so in tune with what's happening it's a therapy. It's a release of freedom for me to go, there's nothing else in my life that even remotely pops into my mind except for him. But you know, where he's at. You know, how I'm gonna do this, how I'm gonna make this better. So it's actually a bunch of fun. And my wife just she enjoys coming to the shows, and she is not about to say, you know, stop this now, because you know, I've been doing this before. I met her and married her 27 years ago.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
So when you guys started out, you know, knowing this would be hugely expensive and time consuming, and you know, the physicality of it all, what made you decide, I gotta do this? This is for me.
A recruiter, I'd have to say, with the previous team that we were on, and he recruited me.
Yeah.
So
we started messing around with formation, flying close to each other 10 years ago. And and kind of did it all every summer a little bit here and there, got other guys involved, and pretty soon we were doing it quite regularly, and another team started formed, and I was asked to kind of join that team, and I had an opportunity to do that, and so I did, and caught the air show bug, and told Ken, who basically started teaching me formation 10 years ago, is, hey, you need to do this. This is a lot of fun. And so I brought him along on the team, and we had a great time. We had a chemistry. We were able to practice together a lot away from the team. And we decided to just come up with our own routine. And people liked it and asked us to perform at shows. Kay, can you come do our show? And we did. And found that it was easier for us to just fly as Redline as opposed to with the other team. And
more fun, more aerobatics for us. And what was interesting is it all started at Waynesville. And we flew a couple of shows there. We flew one show, actually. But we would go there and practice quite a bit. And before we know it, you know, somebody asked us to fly that show. And somebody saw us there and asked us for a couple other shows. So there were a few shows that developed. And somebody from there saw us from Cleveland, and then it started, it actually grew on its own. So most of those shows were not us necessarily going out trying to find them, but the folks finding us. And so it was a natural fit. And, you know, we fly such a dynamic two-ship formation show, and there's just not a lot of guys that do it like that out there. There were very few two-ship formation acts around the whole country.
So how'd you come up with the Redline name?
It's
all you.
I'll try to make it short. I was flying at an airline, and another pilot was flying with us, riding along, and he had to make a connection, and he was sleeping in the cockpit, and I was descending.
Jump seeker.
I was descending into, I don't know where it was, Orlando or something like that. And the overspeed warning was going off, the clacker. It starts, I was at the red line, and so I eased up, and he woke up, and he said, John, wait, I'm in a hurry. The red line is the goal, not the limit. And that's where it came from. Isn't that funny? But so we thought, of, you know.
And it's really the way we fly. I mean, it's not really pressing the red line on the airplane or the equipment necessarily, but it's actually flying the red line on our own personal abilities. You know, how we approach our flying is, you know, we don't want to cross red line because that is the limit, but we want to get as close to it as we can, and there you go.
That's cool.
Yeah. So with all your aviation experience, from the formal to the fun, everything in between, what advice could you give somebody to live their life and go after their passions?
Is to go after the passion, and don't just dream, do it.
Yeah.
Do it.
Don't be afraid of failure.
Don't wait. Mm-hmm. Don't be afraid to fail. That's a pretty big one right there. Don't be afraid to fail.
Yeah, the first step is the most important step, and then the next step after that is persistence. Stick with it. Just stay the course. You'll hear more no's than you do yeses in any career, but specifically aviation. And you just take the next step. And it's, you know, you look at a mountain. My mom used to say, try to move a mountain. It's just one scoop at a time, but it'll get moved.
So this one's kind of a fun one, but sort of off topic, since a lot of aerobatics are involved in attack and evade maneuvers, if you guys were thrown into either World War One, World War Two, your choice, which plane would you best fit in?
I would say, well, everybody would probably say the Mustang. I'd probably say the Mustang.
I told her the other day, she asked me this question earlier, so I knew it was coming.
I couldn't handle it, had to ask.
Yeah, for me, it's the F4U Corsair. And we were at Langley, and Jim
Topol
was there with his airplane. And so we're all performers, we're standing around, it's raining, we got a little bit of rain out at the evening for that one. And I said to him, you know, with a beer in my hand, can I go sit in your airplane? And and he smiled, and he was in, you know, a bunch of people around, and everybody saying, hey, don't make a mess in the airplane. But you can go over there and climb in. And to sit in something like that with all that history, of course, I got some selfies.
And of course.
Yeah, of course, put those on the Facebook. But it was so neat to get in that and feel all that history in there. Bob Black Sheep on that TV show.
We just got done watching that.
Watching that and going, man, you know, I was too young. At that time I was, you know, 15 or, you know, 8 years old, going, man, I'd love to fly one of those.
Because of that show, as a side note, we went to the Tri-State Warbirds Museum.
Yeah.
Sports pilot, and they're putting together a Corsair. I couldn't handle it. There's nobody there. So I asked the docent who's walking us around, I said, can I lay on that wing?
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you know about the Corsair they have there?
No, I don't.
It's from the old Baba Black Sheep show.
Really?
Was it crated up for a while or something in the back lot somewhere, and they've got it, and they're going to put it back together and make it flyable.
Yeah.
So it's...
The design...
And where it came from originally, I forget. I don't know if it ever made it overseas. I think it was a late model, like a 45 or something.
But I would have to say, if in a modern-day airplane now, after flying aerobatics in formation and doing all this our low-level stuff, and being involved in crew in an airline, I think I would probably rather fly the AC-130 gunship.
Yeah.
With all the firepower, plus you have a built-in party wherever you go.
Yeah.
Five or six guys, you're always going to have a good time. So I've kind of switched, actually. I've thought about that. I think I would rather do that than fly a fighter. I think it would be more fun.
That's my second favorite answer.
And there's nothing like sitting in a C-47 and watching the flames fly out the back of the engine as they try to start it.
Yeah.
Oh, that gets your attention in a hurry.
Yeah.
So living or dead, who would you guys want to fly with? Or sit on the back porch and drink a beer and talk with?
Bob Hoover. I've been watching him since I was young here at Dayton. When he brought the yellow Mustang, remember that? That's way back. And I remember walking in the hangar one night. My friend of mine was at Mead, and they used to use the Mead hangar to store the show airplanes. And I remember one night they had the airplane in there for whatever reason. It was there for storage that night. And I remember walking in, you know, and I couldn't walk over to see it because he wouldn't let us over there. But Bob Hoover. I just love to pick his brain.
You've met Bob, haven't you?
I have. I've shaken his hand, but... he wouldn't remember me from anybody.
I'm not working at the paper, I'm a photographer for the National Aviation Hall of Fame, and I've spent many, many days with Bob over the years.
Yeah.
Have you seen Kim First's movie, Flying the Feathered Edge?
Not yet.
No, I haven't.
Oh, you've got to see it. It's amazing.
Yeah, we saw him up at our Oshkosh performance last year, which was really kind of cool. He just, you know, pulled up right in front of us, and he's still alive and kicking. So.
Yep, the best of the best.
Yeah.
I'll take Jim Lovell.
Yeah, there you go.
I was a big space fanatic when I was a kid, and he was always my favorite actor, even, you know, from the Gemini days. So I kind of followed his career, got sent away for pictures with that from him, and I haven't got a chance to meet him yet, but he's always been kind of a hero to me.
I met him last year, and I thought he'd be 10 feet tall.
He's the most down-to-earth guy. And funny, oh my goodness.
Yeah.
If you guys ever get a chance to come to National Aviation Hall of Fame entrainment, this year it's October 1st, I think. Mm-hmm. And I can't promise that Jim will be there this year. I don't know who's mm-hmm. going to be there, but I know that, you know what, I'll bet he will be, because last year Chris Kraft was enshrined, and this year, I can't think of the guy's name, the guy who was mission control before Chris Kraft, he's being enshrined. And so I will bet that Lovell will be there.
You know, they, I've been to that many times. They have a pre-party party.
Yes.
Down at Moraine Airport.
On Thursday night. So, the best event of the whole week.
Yeah, I've been there. You know, I don't know how many times, and I've seen.
And you and I have seen each other.
Yeah. Oh, I guess
so. Because I'm down there every year for that.
Yeah. So, Alan Howeller is a good friend of mine, and Mike Brown, and all those guys. So yeah, that is really neat, and my wife and I have been to a few of the events, you know, black tie events, and that is something else. Back when, who was the guy that flew Vietnam, F-86, I'm trying to think of the...
Robin Olds.
F-4s, no, he did, that's it, I'm sorry, it was F-4s. Yeah, Robin Olds, I was there when he got inducted, and that's many years ago, but that's neat.
Funny quick story about Robin Olds. I was out at Nellis Air Force Base shooting some stuff for the Hall of Fame. It's been 10, 12 years ago. And I was talking with a couple of Air Force pilots. They were F-15 pilots. And I don't know how we got talking, but they were saying something about, oh my God, I would give anything to someday meet Robin Olds.
Yeah.
And I said, you would? And they said, yeah. And I said, follow me. Well, Robin Olds was like 10 feet away on the other side of the curtain signing autographs.
Oh.
And I took him around there, and as soon as he found out there were fighter pilots, he just dropped everything and was talking with those guys. But the look on their faces when they found out they were like 10 feet away from Robin Olds.
Yeah, he's such an articulate man with the way he conveyed his feelings of flight, too.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of his writings and everything else and videos that I've seen, and it's like, wow.
Well, that's deep. He's like Mr. Commander. You just look at him and you just felt like you wanted to salute the guy.
Yeah. I got a funny story though, real quick. Bob Hoover. So the guy that taught me how to fly, Ash Estelman, passed away many years ago. When he was teaching me, I think he was 74. And so he'd be 100 plus now. He ran an airport called South Dayton. It used to be Moraine. South Dayton got moved to Moraine. And when he ran that, the guys from Wright Patterson Air Force Base would come down. Bob Hoover and the guys is what he would tell me. And he's telling me this story when I'm, 19 years old taking flight lessons. And he says, yeah, they would come. And Esther was a real quiet guy. He was the airport manager. And he had just hired a female flight instructor. First time.
I know where this is going.
And all the guys were having beers and messing around by the tree. And Esther comes out. He looks over and these guys are all laughing, and he looks at his champ coming in, and boom, 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 up in the air and back around the pattern again. And they're just howling, and next thing he knows, the airplane pulls up, and he gets the girl gets out, he's walking into the office right away, and the guy's in the airplane, he looks at him, he's got Bob Hoover in there. Well, Bob Hoover had signed up for a flight lesson and acted like he was a brand new student. And scared her.
Pulled a fast one on her.
She quit right on the spot.
Yeah, as I heard it, she was quite a good-looking young lady.
Oh, really?
It was the reason that he
You know more of the story, too?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, no shit.
General Yeager was stationed right Pat at the same time.
Yes, yes. Right.
And I heard it from Chuck Yeager.
Oh, that's funny.
Of course, I don't know how much has been added on to the story over the 50, 60 years afterwards, because Air Force pilots are big storytellers.
Yeah, of course.
But
we never do that. But I thought that was just so funny, because when Ash is telling me this, he goes, yeah, she quit right there. And he says, I called her. I had her last check. It's just so funny to hear him tell the story, being in the airport.
During that same time period, Hoover actually saved an airplane that had lost an engine coming into Wright Pat there was a flatbed truck coming in, and I guess he bounced the wheels off the truck to get enough altitude to clear the fence to make it back to the runway.
Wow.
Hoover is just
out
of this world. And the thing is, it's not just stories, it's stuff he did.
Yeah. So that'd be the guy I'd like to meet.
I used to go to the air shows back, I was like maybe late 70s, early 80s, and didn't he used to perform in a twin engine something that he would cut the engines and do a loop?
Yeah.
Is that, am I remembering that right?
Yeah. He did a loop with no engines.
Yeah, right. Cut the power.
I watched him do that. Yeah, yeah. I've actually flown not that exact airplane, but Shrek Commanders. And,
okay.
And I remember flying it thinking, wow, let's see, Mitch. No, I never, I always wanted to, but I didn't do it.
He would also put a glass of, I think it was wine, on the console. And do a loop and not spill a drop.
Yeah.
And something about the way he did the G's as he went through it.
It's actually that way every time. And if you don't... If
well, I know that we take a bucket of water, and we learned that as little kids. But he did it with a glass of wine sitting on...
Yeah, so I used to take my kids up and on the glare shield put a Coke can that I had sitting there open and put it up there and do a couple of rolls with them. And the Coke stays in the can. Mm-hmm. If it comes out, you did something incorrectly. And if I do something like that incorrectly, then he gets all messed up. Because he can't hang it.
And he laughs at you because you're wearing the Coke.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's video on YouTube of Bob playing that routine from inside the cockpit.
Yeah, I seen pouring a glass. His arm was twisted backwards while he's flying, but he's pouring a glass of water on his
own. And he's doing all these maneuvers and all this and just talking in the most calm voice, never any stress to it. Yeah. It's just like he's having a conversation.
Yeah.
The guy's amazing.
Yeah,
Nate. Now, I'm curious, you still fly commercial? Or did fly commercial?
I did fly commercial.
Who did you fly with?
Flew with DHL.
Okay.
And I both flew for the original DHL that was based in Cincinnati, and then they were kind of merged with Airborne Express in Wilmington, and then we moved up there for a time, and then moved back to CBG, and then our airline was the odd man out. Lost out 4 years ago, so it was dissolved, and so we lost our jobs.
Okay.
So
we
both reinvented ourselves.
Okay.
From airline pilots to air show pilots.
Well, this is more fun than flying a...
It sure is.
I think this is where I'm supposed to be.
Yep. That's
well,
how I feel, too.
A lot of people say everything happens for a reason.
Yeah. Yeah. It feels like all of the years of training and, freight flying and then corporate flying and then back to airline flying was all just, a stepping stone to this.
Yeah.
It's like I didn't realize it at the time, but that's what it feels like now. It's like, wow, it was all for this to get me to this point.
Yeah. Well, and the flying the big planes versus the small, one is a good experience for the other. And as long as you don't have urges like, what was that guy's name? Tex?
Tex Johnson.
Yeah, he was the chief test pilot for Boeing.
Oh,
and did the 707 to prove what it would do.
Twice.
Yeah.
About gave his bosses a heart attack.
Yeah.
But he got fired. And he got fired a couple days later because that turned out to be such a huge bump for the 707's reputation.
Yeah, I wish there were better video of that. I've seen video of it, but it's just so grainy and stuff.
Yeah.
We saw that plane. It's over at Ubar Hazy at the Smithsonian.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Bob Hoover's flight.
Oh, is it? And that's true? Okay.
So what's been your proudest moment being involved with Red Line?
This is coming kind of close.
Yeah.
Dayton or Oshkosh, getting invited to Oshkosh.
Flying at Oshkosh last year. Seems like every year we have some show that we wind up doing. It was like, wow, I can't believe we got to do that show. We did Oshkosh last year. We also did the Pensacola, NAS Pensacola show, the hometown, homecoming show for the Blue Angels, and they have a big reception at the Naval Air Museum there, and it's an honor to be involved there. It's a huge honor, Oshkosh, so probably Oshkosh.
Yeah, Oshkosh, Pensacola, rank right up there, NAS, and then this one would probably be the next for us.
Yeah. If you've been going to Oshkosh over the years, did you ever get to meet Paul Pobrezny, who was your, what a nice guy.
Yeah, sure is.
And who is that?
He was the founder of the EAA.
Okay.
And a World War II P-51 pilot. Just a tremendous guy, but he built the EAA from the ground up. What it is now is all thanks to Paul Pobrezny and then his son Tom, who... I don't think he's still got a title, but he doesn't. Jack Pelton runs it now, doesn't
right?
he?
Right, yeah. Mm-hmm.
But it is a neat show just to be involved in. The energy that's there is something else, you know. And and Sean Tucker last year. This is, we'd flown with another team at Oshkosh, but now we're flying as Red Line, and which is more sweet for us. And so we're just putting on our flight suits, and we're both in this air-conditioned room, that big room, briefing area, and it's just the two of us. And Sean comes walking out through one door to walk out the building, and he stops, he turns around, he looks at us, he says, pretty cool, isn't it? Remember this, guys. This,
yeah.
This is the show. This is Oshkosh. And Kim sticks his hand out.
Coming from Sean Tucker.
Coming from Sean Tucker. Sticks his hand out, shakes both of our hands, aggressively goes, I gotta go fly.
Oh my God.
But it was, you know, for him to just stop for a moment in his busy, you know, getting ready to go, to stop it and acknowledge that he knew this, he knew we'd flown before, but he knew this meant so much more. That was pretty cool.
Do you guys have any advice for people who are afraid to fly? Just straight line, afraid to fly.
Boy.
Don't fly with me. Don't fly with me. You know, I always have a tough time with folks that do have a hard time flying. It's a, you know, you drive down the street or ride a bike or go on a roller coaster or you know, sit on your back deck and something can happen. So if I look at flying and how many times I've flown or we've flown as a, you know, human beings and go, you know, stuff happens, but you know, you're looking at it from individual accidents point of view or one airliner goes down. And you know, how many airliners flew that day? I don't think there's any correlation in logic there. So,
you guys probably haven't had any contact much with the Traverse City people yet, have you? As far as the
they started contact.
Yeah.
I got a couple emails this week.
I'll get with you sometime next week. In years past, I had gone up to Traverse City covering the Blue Angels from the big ship called the State of Michigan. Mm-hmm. Which serves the show center.
Yep, I know it is.
And
been on it.
I contacted the admiral who runs the academy just a couple days ago and said I'd like to go out. And he said, well, the State of Michigan is going to be underway somewhere else in the Great Lakes, so it's not going to be show center this year.
Oh.
And I'm trying to make arrangements to go up. I'm assuming that the Blue Angels will be back in business by then, but...
We hope we don't know. We hope so, but we don't, yeah.
Well, the thing is, if I don't plan for it, and they are... but I'm trying to find out who is
John
going to
Cudahy,
be.
John Cudahy, you know who John Cudahy is?
No.
He is the president of ICAS. Regulatory for airshow pilots. He just sent, reposted a release that was on Facebook, and they were talking that they don't know when the Blues are going to start. They know they've only canceled two shows, which is this one next week, and this weekend was
Syracuse.
So those are the only two that they've canceled, but they're looking at years past and how it generally works, and there's some speculation it would be the Pensacola Beach show, which is 2 weeks after...
after Traverse City.
Yeah, that's speculation, okay.
Well,
but he reposted it, and if he sends it out, I got to say probably say it's got some credibility somewhere. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Does anybody have any idea what happened with the Blue Angel?
Yeah, I've seen some video of the reverse Cuban, but the trees are in the way. You can't see what happens after that.
That's a shame.
Yeah.
I'm just a conspiracy theorist at heart, but I just have trouble believing that the number 6 aircraft with the Blue Angels and Thunderbirds both crashed within a 90-minute period.
Mm-hmm.
That's just too weird.
Mm.
Coincidence.
Yeah, hard to speculate, but I have no comment there. I wish I had.
Yeah. Well, I mean, like you were saying earlier, is the nature of the business.
It is the nature of the business.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, one, you know, there's so many things, you know, that's flying. It's multitasking. It's a whole bunch of things going on in front of you. All of them are easy. Every single item is easy. I got to pull, I got to push, I got to press a button, whatever. But you put them all together, And then you prioritize and go, I tell my students when I fly with them, these are the items that are going to kill you fast. Address those. These are going to kill you slow. Let's get to those later. You got to get to, still get to them. You know, you're landing, you're down, at this point may not be an issue. Now, toward the end of the flight, just before landing, you better double check. But, you know, so it's kind of, and that's aerobatic flying to the extreme. You know, when you're pulling up going, I have enough energy for this and this and this and this, and okay, I got to give up. And I got to abort this, or now I got to recover. You know, it's just,
and then what you said, plus the stresses on the body at the same time.
Right.
It just, I don't know. I've flown with Sean doing aerobatics, and obviously my hands are busy taking pictures, but I know that, you know, he's doing all this stuff at the same time, and it amazes me still.
Yeah. For me, the formation flying is, the formation aerobatics is like the top of the pyramid. Not only do I have a drinking buddy that buys beers at every place we go to, but sometimes when we're flying, though, it's so cool to get this matched up on the aerobatic side. And that, you know, when we're doing that barrel roll and he's on my wing, you know, and I'm looking out, I know roughly where he should be. And, you know, we've done so many barrel rolls together. I'm looking at him and trying to match what I'm doing to make sure I make him look good, you know, through the routine.
That's what I think a lot of people don't understand about formation flying. If you look at close-ups in particular, the Blue Angels and Thunderbirds, and when they're flying in a line where you can see all of them, you see one guy looking straight ahead, and everybody else is looking this way. They're not looking, I mean, all they're doing is looking at what's right beside them.
Yeah.
And I don't think a lot of people understand the coordination involved in that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That's why I only look at, I'm only looking at him and trusting him to not hit the ground.
Yeah.
You know, he could fly us right into the ground. I wouldn't even know.
20 years ago, maybe now, when the Thunderbirds lost four aircraft.
Following
that way, I mean, one guy flew into the ground, and the rest of them
followed him in.
Didn't know what was happening.
Yeah. So
we got to talk to the Blue Angels 2 years ago, and they were in Dayton. And one of the questions was, they flew over Cincinnati, coming to Dayton, and I got to talk to the lead pilot and asked him, said, "How was the view?" Because they were flying pretty low. He goes, "For me, it was great, but none of the other guys got to see it because they were watching me."
Yeah.
You know, like, good point.
Yeah.
That's something that, for all I know, somebody's done it, but somebody needs to do a GoPro video of the other pilots, because I mean, all they're going to see is straight to their left or right.
If you got a chance to, you know, mess around the computer, Redline Air Shows on YouTube, and we put quite a few videos up. Some are old, and it seems like a search engine on there just pops up whatever comes up when first. But if you look at like Redline Air Shows 2015 or Langley, a couple more recent videos, I got videos of us from GoPros on the wings all over. Not GoPros, sorry, Verbs. Garmin gave us cameras. We're supposed to say Verbs. Verbs on it. But the point of view of when I got a camera on my wing pointing at him, and the whole time, yeah, he's, you know, it almost looks like he's asleep.
Just watching you.
He's in a daze. But you know how much focus and concentration he's got. He'll be passing underneath me. You'll see my smoke line going by. He's, you know, looking at my belly as he's going by, and the focus that he's got on. It's kind of neat.
Yeah. Well, I know something that you get used to just like anything else, but first time I flew with the Aerosol Squadron, and getting used to being 1,000, 2,000 feet in the air and having an airplane 6 feet from you, I don't know, there's just something a little weird about that in the beginning, because you feel like you're just right on top of them. And from flying myself, I just know, you know, sometimes you feel like you're just jostled all over the air.
Right.
And I just keep thinking, you know, what happened to your air pocket or something like that. But
we're so close, we have the same air pocket.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That's really, there's a lot of truth to that right there. It's easier to fly.
So being wing, the tighter you are, the better off you are.
I flew wing on the other team, so rather than lead. And, you know, so you really feel after you're comfortable in the position, that the closer you are to the other airplane, in some ways, the easier it is. So, you know, extreme rough air, you know, there's always exceptions to those rules. But for the most part, that's the truth, especially on our aerobatics. So if he's way down here for aerobatics, it's much harder for him to fly than if he's right tucked in there nice and tight.
I never thought of it that way.
Can I go back to night flying? My mind's spinning here going, two things you got to be able to see at night, each other and the ground. Now, each other, I assume you have your own, like, running lights and other lights on your wings and maybe canopy, too, I don't know, or in your cockpit. I don't know what all's lit up to see each other. But also on the ground, I mean, obviously, a place like this, there's not a lot of ground lights other than maybe lampposts on a farmhouse. What are you using for reference, or do you have to put your own lights out somewhere in a darkened area to see the ground?
Night presents its own difficulties, exactly for that, finding the horizon. Ground lights help us a lot. We change some things at our night show so we don't have to rejoin. We start out together, then we never get back together again because that's difficult to do. We have them turn the runway lights up full bright so that we have that in the periphery. It is difficult if we're out in the country someplace. A terminal or something like that helps us. Lights do help us. So,
you know, a lot of times it's like you were saying, we take off in formation. We fly to our opening in formation. So I have lights that we have on the airplane, and we've got lights shining back at us at our tail, so it's kind of lit up. And then we do a few maneuvers together, and then we do split because it's kind of cool to split. We go into the trail, and we don't come back together. We'll split further from there, go in opposite directions, and we land separate. So, I mean, we keep it further and further apart, and we don't come back together, which simplifies some things. From the spectator's point of view, they look down and just go, oh, it looks cool. They're just changing their maneuver. For us, we did it in that order so that it keeps things clear. As far as the ground goes, you know, that's my responsibility because he's still flying on me. And we discovered real early on that once I leave his vision, you know, I've been acting as his reference point the whole time, and I'm gone. So we changed the way we did our routine because of it, knowing that at this point, it's easy for him to figure out where things are at. But back to your staring at during formation, I mean, there's times that, you know, when lead says, you can break away, you gotta go, okay, which way am I going? And on the larger teams, you'll hear lead say, if there's an emergency for wing, he'll say, wing, you know, turn 3 o'clock, airport's, you know, 4 miles. Because at that moment, you got an emergency of any sort, and you're like, where do I go? Which direction is it? Because I've been looking at you the whole time.
Mm-hmm. Well, I have done over the years a lot of stuff with Sean and Mike Goulian as far as the photo flights and stuff. And with Sean in particular, he will spend 30, 45 minutes going over every single aspect of the flight, even with Photoshop, before we ever leave, and everybody knows exactly what they're going to do. In case of an emergency, you know, okay, this plane's going this way, this plane's going that way, and he's very meticulous about that sort of a thing.
Yeah, it's the non-standard stuff. We learned this with, other places we've flown, it's the non-standard stuff that's generally the most dangerous.
Yeah. We did
this is calling our air show here standard. That is our standard. So we know how to do that. We know where to expect everybody.
When you start adding other
stuff. If I add a photo flight, all of a sudden, nothing about what we're doing is what we normally do.
It's been 7 or 8 years ago, Jim Brown, when he was still CEO here, wanted to do a photo flight before the Hartzell Air Show. We had Sean, Michael, Mike Bohannon, Bruce Bohannon, Ed Hamill, and then he had 2 or 3 other of his own aircraft, and he wanted this formation flight thing. And of course, I said yes because that kind of opportunity doesn't come along every day. Man, I thought Sean was going to have cow when he was laid with this mission. Mm-hmm. And we walked through we walked for an hour in the hangar walking through this whole thing, how it was going to be, and it was real simple, just nice, easy banks over the city of Piqua and over Hartzell's things. But man, I thought Sean was going to have a heart attack when he said, okay, we're only going to put like 9 planes together here plus the Photoshop.
Yeah.
But it worked out.
That's what sunk the XB-70.
Yeah.
Photo Flight.
Yeah.
Oh, is that right?
What was it?
Photo Flight, and the person flying the fighter that was with it was
the F-104 or something.
I think it was.
There's a picture of that, isn't there?
The wingtip vortices got in.
Oh man!
Threw him into the airplane.
Oh my God! My favorite airplane ever, the XB-70.
Oh
yeah!
I watched it come into Dayton when
you watched it land.
Yeah.
Really?
My dad took us down there when it made its final flight in the museum. And all for crying out loud, my mind went blank.
What year would that have been?
Had to have been late 60s.
Really?
That's, what I would have
guessed. That's cool.
Right in that vicinity. But God, I can't think of his name. Fritz Fulton was one of the test pilots for the XB-70. Fortunately, he wasn't flying that day. Mm-hmm. But got to know Fitz real well over the years, and he told stories about flying the XB-70 and stuff, and every time I was around him, I felt like I was 10 years old and just listening to him.
Yeah.
God.
Yeah.
But what an airplane.
Well, speaking of, what are you guys' favorite airplane?
You mean like at the Air Force Museum?
Okay. I'm a B-17 girl. I love the shoo-shoo.
The B-58 Hustler.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Nice choice.
Yeah.
No question. That's my favorite.
I've caught between the F4U Corsair or the Mosquito.
Oh, yeah.
I really like Mosquito.
Yeah.
All whatever.
Good, yeah.
Or
yeah.
My second favorite up there is the P-26 Baby Blue Pea Shooter.
Oh, the Pea Shooter.
Yeah.
Oh,
wow.
Yeah. Yeah. It's such a pretty airplane, the way it's painted. It's just a... cool.
I love the Warthog. I mean, everybody calls that ugly.
I'd like that, too. When I was in the Air Force ROTC in college, and thought I was going to go on and be an Air Force pilot. I didn't work out, defense cutbacks and everything, but that was the airplane I wanted to fly.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, Warthog. So, neat airplane.
Now, can I ask a quick question on the propellers, since we're here at Hartzell?
Yeah.
Are they fixed? Are they variable pitch? I don't know much about propellers, but...
They're advanced structural composite propellers. They're 76 inches in diameter. We've been flying them for about 3 years now. And it's one of the best propellers I've ever flown.
It's amazing. So you get to the aluminum propeller, which I had the other Hartzell propeller on the airplane, and it was about that wide. And this new one's about that wide. And what that does for us is it gives us a whole lot more climb. And I got in a race with Mike the other day, and we tested it out equal, and I blew him away. But so it gives us more climb. But the other thing is braking power. So you pull back on the power, it's like somebody just put a parachute up.
For the drag.
For our rejoin, so he can come rocketing in with a, you know, 20 or 30 knot closure rate and pull back on the power and it slows you down pretty quick.
Now those are fixed, they're not?
No, they move.
They do move,
they're
okay.
Variable.
Okay.
Yeah, constant speed we call it.
Okay, so they are self-adjusting, they kind of do that
they
on
do
their
that,
own?
So it works on oil pressure of the engine. So as the oil pressure in an engine increases, it changes the pitch of the propeller because the oil flows through the prop hub.
Okay.
Yeah.
Huh.
That's how that works.
Huge advances.
Yeah, yeah. Those go all the way back to World War II, though.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you know, each one of the propellers is designed differently for a mission, and that's the mission that we're using it for is great. So.
Now the Brown family will love that.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I think we're actually scheduled to fly with you guys Thursday, Friday.
Yeah, I think Chris and I are going at the same time.
Are you?
Yeah.
Oh, great.
Yeah, okay. Surprised to see us again.
Yeah, I didn't, Sheila called me yesterday. I guess we got a couple of rides and maybe a third later in the day, but yeah.
Can ours be more fun than everybody else's?
Yes. Camera's off.
No. I won't bring a GoPro because it conflicts with your Garmin.
Yeah.
They probably make it so it doesn't fit in the slot on the wing.
It does. It actually is a different mount. But if you guys bring, we're going to have GoPros available, or we're going to have Verbs available. So so if you want to, we'll just pop out our card, pop yours in, do what you want.
We just got an email last night to bring a 32 gig Actually, she looks like 32 megabyte, but I'm sure she meant gigabyte.
I told Sheila, I said that would be the easiest is for you guys just to bring new cards for us.
Now, you're talking memory cards, not thumb drives. I think she was thinking of the thumb drive.
Yeah, micro SDs.
Micro SDs.
Okay. Oh, you want, you want the 32 gigabyte card.
The little tiny card. That way, all I got to do is push it in the camera. Just have it clean. I'll just put it in the camera. Get everything while we're flying and pull it out and hand it to you and we're done for the day. Rather than me trying to have you guys download all my your footage off my camera.
I'm glad you clarified that.
Now that's not like Sean who has a crew there who he hands him stuff.
If you get four cards, we have four cameras.
Yeah.
So we can mount them. You can have multiple.
Wow. If you look at our videos when you're messing around, we're welcome to use them too. But if you look at the video, especially like the Langley, it looks like we've got cameras in all these positions. Every day we fly, we move them around to get more of these shots. So it's pretty, it works out great.
Is Langley over water?
It is not. It's round water, though.
Yeah, I knew it was close. I didn't know if the show was.
Peninsula. Yeah, no, it's right there over the base. And we're sitting in the, what was it, the 122nd fighter group bar, 27th fighter group bar. And, you know, looking around, you know, there's a lot of history going through this place. Yeah.
Now, is 127th now F-22s?
It's all F-22s.
Both planes are 22s. 90 of them over there.
So I guess we'll get to see that fly this weekend.
F-22 and F-35.
The 35's going to fly?
Yeah, not there yet, according to what they were telling me, but this is 2 months ago now. We flew there, so.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, I mean, as far as flying, as long as I'm there when it flies in.
Oh, sure.
Usually they'll do a couple of passes. Mm-hmm. And
They got one coming to this show, don't they?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So you're planning to go to Traverse City?
I'm working on it.
Okay.
I hope to be up there. My sole purpose was the Blue Angels, but now that I'm getting to know you guys and stuff and I have family in Traverse City, kind of a good excuse to go up and maybe write it off as a business expense.
There you go. Do you know the air show director, Steve Plamondon?
I do not.
Okay, he's the guy that's the contact for the show.
Because it's funny, I told somebody, maybe I was telling you that I was there just a few years ago shooting the Blue Angels, and I looked it up a couple nights ago. It was 10 years ago this year, so
those are nice pictures.
It's been a while. Mm-hmm. But that is the most unique way to shoot an air show. From show center, and there was times when the Blue Angels were actually flying below our eye level.
Yeah.
Oh my God. Yeah. Amazing.
Yeah.
It's always neat for us to fly over water. You'll find this kind of interesting. You fly a show in a day like this, and it'll be bumpy, and you'll see clouds like this. And if you look up at the clouds, you'll see that the clouds stop at the water edge.
Yep.
And for us as performers, we'll fly out over the water and we're just bouncing, and as soon as we hit the water, it is smooth. And it's like flying at night. So all of a sudden, John pulls in an extra couple of feet closer, and because it's just like everything can be tightened up. It's great. Yeah.
My long cross-country flight when I was getting my license many, many years ago took me up to Port Clinton. And that was the first time I'd been around water in an airplane, so I kind of cheated and flew out over Lake Erie for a little bit. And that's the first thing I noticed was the ride, it was middle of summer.
Yeah.
And the ride got real smooth.
Yeah.
So,
probably, I don't know, 5 water shows a year in Pensacola and Ocean City, New Jersey. And so every time we, first thing we pick out, even Evansville, remember that? Evansville is a real wide area of the river right there. It was the same effect. It's like, I didn't expect that.
Well, the one thing that I missed when I was shooting the Blue Angels over the water, doggone blue airplanes and blue water. You just kind of, I'd seen it before and I missed it when they were doing it. They actually fly low enough where the airplane makes a big rooster tail in the water. And I so wanted a photo of that. And it was a high speed pass and he was by me before I knew he was there.
Yeah, that's amazing. Hmm.
Now, both of you, dumb question, parachutes. Are you parachutists? Yes, Have you jumped out of airplanes and then?
I've got I used to fly skydivers.
Okay.
So I've got a little over 100 jumps.
Okay. So that would come in handy if you had to, for some reason, bail. You've
His
got
dad
that experience.
Was a Caterpillar Club member. He had to bail out one time.
Oh.
You know what that is?
No.
back in World War II, I guess if you jumped out of an airplane, you would, and survive, you would get a card being in the Caterpillar Club because their parachutes were made of silk at that time.
Yeah.
So he's got a card at home. He had to bail out on a mission.
Wow.
But yeah, he flew B-26 Marauders.
Yeah.
And you were talking about, that's kind of a variable pitch came to mind because they had the Hamilton Standard propellers. And again, you're talking 1940 technology. What was it called? Electric pitch that they could control the pitch, but it was, you had to adjust it in the plane.
Yeah.
You know, you lost an engine, you'd have to feather your prop on the,
right.
on the dead engine. Mm-hmm. So, but that was probably new technology back then, being able to do that
sure
kind
was.
Of thing. And F4s, I think, had similar, I think, similar propellers and variable pitch.
Talking about jumping, a couple years ago, Airshow Sheila had me wing walking. She said, okay, we're going to have you jump, you're going to have a parachute. I'm like,
nope.
I don't care how cute that guy is strapped to my back. There's no way. That terrifies me. She still
got stuck jumping with your cute guy.
He didn't. She gave me crap for that just the other day.
Where'd you do that?
She walked on the wing of Gene Wicker's airplane, actually, the day before the crash.
Oh, wow.
But,
that's incredible. Yeah.
Too chicken to jump, though.
Yeah.
If somebody offered me $1 million, I would not get on top of an airplane.
Oh, I bet you would.
I'll bet I would.
I'll bet.
Yeah. Buy you the
liar.
Well, maybe if it's just sitting on the ground.
Right.
Well, thank you guys so
yes,
much.
Yes, thank you very much. Sure. Pleasure. Yeah. Pleasure.
Speaking of bars, I wish I could bring you guys up to the American Legion and eat some beer and listen to y'all.
Yeah, I know. All the lies come out at that point.
That's the best part. I actually was going to ask you if you had any fun lies that you could share with us, but I was like, yeah, that might be bad for.
Yeah, I know.
Although
I got ones I can share about him. So, let's start with this one.
You gonna try to make it to the Air Force Museum sometime this week to see the new hangar? Or?
Oh, I know. They just officially opened it
Wednesday or Thursday.
Yeah, Wednesday.
Yeah.
And today is the official grand opening.
Yes, today.
Yeah.
That's
right. I got an email and a photo this morning from the director of the National Aviation Hall of Fame. Said, "Why aren't you down here?" I said, "Oh, because I'm out watching people fly." She said, "Show off."
Yeah, I'm a member. Joined it many years ago of the museum, and so I get all that. I knew it was going to open soon, but I used to go to the Christmas concert every
year. Oh yeah,
I missed that.
Yep.
I missed that.
Yeah, that place.